What's up, everybody? Welcome back to another highly combustible reaction. We're going to be jumping in the next one on our Rijksmuseum tour. This is night number 3. Let's go. We got one more night after this. Once again, this was coming at us via donation from Mikhail. Much, much love for the support, for taking us on this journey of your workplace, because it has been spectacular so far. This has been a very, very cool little journey through kind of some Dutch history. Let's jump into it. Let's check it out together. Let's roll.
And what has been the great driving purpose behind this massive reconstruction? Well, fundamentally, to turn the museum itself into a blank canvas upon which the curators can hang the works in such a way that they tell the story of the Dutch and of Holland. And what a story it is.
Over the centuries, the Dutch state has taken many forms. A relatively small area, it emerged from the Middle Ages with disproportionate power and influence, thanks to a native talent for trade. The famously flat land of the Low Countries has never produced enough agriculture to support itself, so commerce has always been essential.
Okay.
The principles of free trade and the tolerance that made that possible have always been at the heart of the Dutch national psyche. Holland's origins as an independent state lie in a violently colonial relationship with the great villains of Dutch history, the Spanish.
There were anti-Spanish songs that were published and people would sing them, and there were books all about the horrible crimes of the Spanish and how the Dutch suffered under the Spanish, particularly in the first...
That whole songs and poems about it? That's... I'm trying to think. Yeah, I don't even think America has any poems about anybody coming to destroy them or songs like that.
...crimes of the Spanish and how the Dutch suffered under the Spanish, particularly in the first half of the 17th century.
Yes. Maybe it was almost like a kind... That anti-Spanish feeling was almost like a kind of glue needed to cement together this new nation.
Yes, the idea nowadays that you cement a nation, you make a nation by setting up another, a strong other, and for the Dutch, the Spanish were the other.
The roots of the conflict reach back to 1555, when control of mainly Protestant Holland passed to the fanatically Catholic Spaniard Philip II. With a hateful mistrust of his subjects, he set out to suppress them.
So how did the Dutch react to Philip's repressive policies? Well, they attacked what he loved most, the very fabric of the Catholic Church. They attacked its superstitions, they attacked its priests, they attacked the buildings that represented Philip and his faith.
Oh, wow!
They pulled down statues, they smashed stained glass windows, they destroyed paintings. You can see it all here, laid out in vivid detail, the iconoclastic rage, it was called. Now this...
It's so detailed, look at the cracks in the marble. They really went down to the gnat's ass detail in their paintings. And we're lucky that they did, because we still have them today to look at. Imagine how many things we wouldn't even know about if it wasn't for paintings. Like...
Violent upsurge of popular unrest expressed against Philip, against Spain, against Catholicism. It would lead to the Great War of Dutch Independence, a war so bloody and so protracted that its very name conveys the pain of it all, the 80 Years' War. Iconoclasm, the destruction of art, the desecration of a sacred space. Well, you might think that all that is safely in Holland's Reformation past, but have a look at this. Now, this is the Great Hall. Isn't it fantastic?
Great,
I think anybody coming to the magnificently revamped Rijksmuseum will instantly understand that this...
Look at the size of this building. It's like 60 people tall. What a giant stained glass window. That is a gorgeous
building. This represents the beating heart of the institution. It represents everything that it was founded to say to the world about Holland. What we have are scenes of Dutch history, emblems of the proud spirit of Dutch independence. It's got that kind of wonderful 19th century sentimental illogicality that you find in the V&A and buildings like that in Britain. But it's what a wonderfully exuberant expression of the idea that art is our temple. But believe it or not, the history of Dutch iconoclasm, the history of the war between the Protestant and the Catholic, was played out in this very space in the 1950s, when an officious public director of works decided that this great space was giving people the wrong idea about Holland. Holland was, as far as he was concerned, Holland was Protestant. It was logical, it was clinical, it was sensible, it wasn't artistic, it wasn't Catholic. So what did he do? Can you believe it? He had the whole space whitewashed.
Oh.
Whitewashed.
They found everything underneath his whitewash and brought it back to life?
In the 1950s, 60s, the Dutch became less and less religious. You had in literature, you have books writing about terrible religious parents who make you pray before every meal. And that was the time that they wanted to get rid of this religious Catholic building. And also modernism helped them with it because you could paint everything white.
There was a twisted historical logic behind this architectural desecration. Whitewashing the Great Hall was a modern tribute to the sparse Dutch Protestant churches of the Reformation. Restoring it to its former glory took painstaking effort.
Can you imagine how much it would have took to restore that? You know how long it takes to paint a bedroom? Imagine trying to strip the paint off of a single room. This is like a gigormous hall.
Extraordinary aspect of an already pretty extraordinary story is the fact that this guy actually asked the principal conservator of paintings, a wonderful lady called Manya, who sadly is too ill to be in this show. He ordered her to destroy the paintings. Can you believe that? Telling the conservator of the Rijksmuseum to destroy paintings, to burn them.
How?
But she didn't.
Could you tell
she hid
her
them.
To do that?
And now, thanks to the enlightened attitude of the modern renovators of the Rijksmuseum, they're back in place. It's a pretty amazing story.
That's crazy. Good on her.
Now, if you look through the 800 years spanned by the Rijksmuseum's collection, there's one period in particular which I think would set anyone's imagination on fire. The Dutch 17th century, they call it the Golden Age, and with good reason, because it was then, extraordinarily, that this tiny seafaring nation became the great powerhouse of world politics, world trade, world finance. Quite simply, the most powerful country in the world, and also the most creative in terms of painting.
At the time, Holland was a political anomaly. Despite having a population of less than 2 million, it had confidently renounced Spanish and papal rule and functioned as a republic. Without the straitjacket of the established order, still in place throughout most of Europe, Dutch trade boomed. Holland flourished.
So who ruled this new society, this new nation, Holland? Well, it wasn't any king or prince, it wasn't the pope or any priest. It was men like these, prosperous members of a rising merchant middle class, the burger citizens of Amsterdam.
We have this extraordinary case of a country that is very small, and they were by far the richest country in all of Europe and in all of the world, and not just because...
The smallest? Come on now. Small, comparatively speaking, was the richest in the world. That's crazy. Alright. Hey, if this is one of the most informative documentaries, seriously, seriously, very intriguing. Like, the whole thing, 100%, the Rijksmuseum is getting visited.
The richest country in all of Europe and in all of the world. And not just because they had some very rich people, but because wealth was also spread very widely for the time. So there was a broad middle class that was able to participate in this extraordinary culture.
Now, of course, you can't walk into the world of the past, but I think this is the next best thing. What a wonderful object it is. It's a 17th century doll's house. Must have cost a fortune. It was certainly, I suspect, one of the more expensive Christmas presents given in the year 1675. What's fascinating about it as well is that it offers us, almost as a microcosm, the ideal home of the rich Dutch merchant class, the burgher. This is how he was supposed to live. Notice, these people are avid collectors. They're fascinated by painting. They've got a Raphael on their wall, an old master, and over the fireplace in the main room, behind the master of the house and the mistress, there's a beautiful Dutch still life painting. Painting everywhere.
What a very cool dollhouse.
In this prosperous, emerging Dutch state, the church and the nobility had been usurped from their customary role as the biggest patrons of the arts. The Dutch merchant class filled the gap, creating a thriving middle-class art market. Painters were reliant from now on the private citizens' patronage, and they responded with an energy that more than matched the vigor of the merchants themselves.
Art as a commodity, an object of trade and exchange, had well and truly arrived.
Each new specifically Dutch form of painting produced its own new genius. The cheekily vibrant portraits of Frans Hals, the air-filled landscapes of Hobbema, the sun-drenched idylls of Kuyp, Vermeer's hymns to domesticity.
And the most famous of them all, Rembrandt.
So where did they get the cash to pay for this amazing art boom? Answer: expanding Dutch trade.
The Netherlands have always been on a crossroads of trade routes. So the trade between the Mediterranean and the north and England and the continent and the German hinterland all had to pass through this, the Low Countries.
Now, if you wanted to dominate world trade in the 17th century, there was really only one way to do it. You had to rule the waves, and Dutch maritime supremacy was the key to Dutch trading success. And unsurprisingly, Dutch art is full of images that celebrate the Dutch obsession with the sea.
My goodness.
No one paints the details of ships, their rigging, their sails filled by the...
Look at everything, even the smoke. Everything is so real. The smoke into the clouds, into the ships. Oh, goodness!
When their cannon belching out flame and smoke, no one paints that with more obsessive interest in detail than the Dutch artist.
Stuck in the lift.
This is the Maritime Gallery of the Rijksmuseum. It's one of the most spectacular spaces. Look, they're putting the finishing touches to this wonderful Dutch man of war. And pride of place is occupied by this painting. And what it reminds us of is the fact that the Dutch naval expansion in the 17th century did not go unnoticed, least of all by the English. The Dutch fought three great naval wars with the English. And this picture commemorates the single most humiliating defeat suffered by His Majesty's Royal Navy in all of history. It's a depiction of the Medway Raid, as it was called. Charles II of England had negotiated a truce with the Dutch, but he'd done so in bad faith. They sniffed it out, and they sailed their ships into the Thames estuary, catching the British Navy by surprise. They set fire to the fleet. These are the heroic Dutch ships coming home, and they towed away, the flagship of the Royal Navy. The man responsible, wow. He's here. Great hero of Dutch history, Michiel de Ruyter. What a man. I mean, you don't want to mess with him, do you? And the story continues as you move through the gallery, because up here, what have we got? Amazing. The only surviving remnant of a 17th century battleship. And what is it? It's the prow of that flagship, towed away by Michiel de Ruyter. And here it is, erected in the stadium.
That's nuts. I literally have chills. I'm like, I don't even know if I've ever been in a room with something that old. Like,
so to speak, of Dutch history as a permanent scoreboard. Holland 1, England 0.
What a piece of history.
Just the destruction of His Majesty's fleet that set the Dutch and English against each other. Soon, it was to be the prize of the English crown itself.
Oh, yeah. There we go. That's the third night of the four-night piece to the Rijksmuseum. We will be jumping into night four tomorrow. If you made it with me this far, I do appreciate each and every one of you. Hit the like button if you liked it, the dislike button if you disliked it. Go show the original poster some love. I'm going to drop it down there inside of the description. Check out one of my other videos up here. Subscribe right here if you want to see more content, possibly your content. Till the next one, I'm Highly Combustible. You guys be happy, healthy, safe. I love you to the moon and back. Peace.